This is more or less a continuation of my last video on this Brunswick model 105. I have here a tale of two Altonas. So this double Altona I want to have rebuilt. This single Altona, I wonder how many parts can be used to rebuild this one, because the paint, the gold tone paint on the inside of this is so much nicer than this one. I don't know if this can be cleaned up or not. The gasket on this one is horrendously cracked up and deteriorated, and I've seen diaphragms for sale on eBay, and I've seen a few other things for sale. For example, the pinion screws and the lock nuts for the lateral transducer, well, the Victor and Pathé needle points. Anyway, these little needle bearings and lock nuts are available. Okay, now to get on with it. I thought that since these are essentially the same to a point, that the balance arm can be mounted on the tone arm of this tone arm, and it will go somewhat, but it does not move freely. It sticks up in the air like that. Another issue is, come on, that the limit stop on the bottom of this one is broken. I really want to use the nickel-plated tone arm for this, because it's more in character of the phonograph. Now, this model 105 originally was shipped with this single Altona, but I have a small number of Edison records that I want to play, and this is kind of why I bought the Altona instead of getting a diamond disc machine. But what I see here is that I can do that, and of course the locking screw I've taken out, or otherwise I wouldn't have been able to pull that out all the way. This will work. So really, I mean, that's an alternate kind of idea that I can do until another nickel-plated tone arm happens to pop its face up on eBay. So anyway, this double Altona, and I've come to actually kind of pick the brains of Mr. Dazer here, because he knows somebody who's up on these Brunswick soundboxes. I guess I'm going to try to free this tone arm, this soundbox, from this balance arm. I've bought some Freol deep penetrating oil. Somebody gave me a hint to spray penetrating oil in the junction in there in the soundbox, where the soundbox mounts to the balance arm, and put it in a freezer. So therefore, I guess the aluminum casting will not contract in size as much as the pot metal on the balance arm. So, with that in mind, I'm going to try to free this single Altona from this nickel-plated balance arm so that I can have all the nickel-plated goodies of the original tone arm on this model 105 and have the double Altona in place to play my actually very small collection of Edison diamond discs. Okay, so that's part one. What do I need to say about this further regarding Mr. Dazer, who can put me in touch with the Altona guy? If I get both of these, if I can get this free, I will send both sound boxes. I'd like to have both of them reworked just for the sake of having both of them reworked. Again, this gold-plated, I guess? It's not brass. Is it really truly gold? I don't know if maybe repeated attacks of brasso might eat that off enough so that it looks like it's actually nickel-plated. Anyway, this mandrel here looks like it's in very nice, smooth condition. I dread to think, once this is freed, what the connection inside there will look like. There, I'm messing up my pot metal again. All right, so that's part one of this thing. Part two is what I'm going to possibly do with this cabinet on this phonograph. 'Cause looking at it, it's kind of in disastrous shape. So we'll have a look at that in a second. Now, looking at the Edison side of this Altona, you can see very clearly that the point is broken off. But not only that, the linkage going to the diaphragm also has pulled out of that little ferrule there. So I don't know whether that would be crimped or epoxied back in place. It looks also that the little hook area might need to be opened up a little bit on there. Let me see if I can get closer in on the mounting where that point was. And that's where the point, the stylus, originally was. Now it's a little crater, and it looks like it's got a little remnant of the shank of the original jewel still in place. So I guess maybe that may need to be drilled out or something else. I don't know what else you would do. And you can see that the gasket is really cracked up and deteriorated all throughout there. So gaskets will need to be replaced on that. And on the lateral and pathé side, the lock nuts and the pivot screws, you know, they're all rusted pretty badly, so that maybe the screws from the other Altona may be used to fix that. The collet for the pathé shank is kind of crunched up on that, but I have another one on the other Altona box, so that's not really a bad problem. But the inside of the sound box, that nasty corrosion in there or bad painting. I don't know if that could be painted or cleaned. I'd like to have that looking as much as possible to good as possible. So I don't know what can be done about that. Possibly the inside of the other Altona head might be used for the inside of that. So I don't know. The diaphragms, they are a bit scratched up and they have some spatters of garbage on them. Looks like Brasso on there. I did not do that to this, but I surely would if given the chance. But if the diaphragms can be replaced to something new and pristine and scratch-free, that would be nice. So we'll talk about that if you want to. As far as the inside of the cabinet goes, there are a few needle pecks that, you know, you kind of have to expect those with these old phonographs. A little bit of veneer pull up there, veneer chipping at the edge of the motor plate. And further up on the inside rim there, that looks, when I had the other Altona on there, it looks like that's where the pathé point jabbed into the wood. And up here, there's some scarring of the wood there that looks like the back of the balance arm dug into the wood there a little bit. I'm not too concerned about those little areas on the interior of the cabinet. In fact, inside the lid, also there's a few things from where the sound box dug into the side of the lid there. That's not too crucial. What I really worry about is losing that decal on there. I really don't want anything to happen to that decal on the inside of the lid. Along the top, there's some rubbing off of the varnish there, some little spots. Murphy's oil soap might even take care of some of those, but we'll have a look at that. One thing I did do is I replaced the cloth on the inside of the grill. So right now it's sort of a patterned print. But I kind of wonder if maybe just a very vibrant red would have been nicer on that. But for the time being, that's how it'll stay. If I decide to change it, I can do it. It's stuck on with a little bit of Elmer's glue, so it can be pulled off. All right, so moving right along to the top of the cabinet, it is scarred and scratched. Veneer cracked, pulling up. I could probably take all this veneer off with a wood chisel, probably carefully take it up. Now this, for you, Scott Aldry, you are the guy I'm actually asking about this, is whether refinishing this cabinet is something that you would be willing to undertake, or do I need to find a professional outlet that deals in antique restoration? This thing is, in my estimation, worth restoring because I haven't seen many of these. And Brunswick is, actually, I've been reading a little bit on the history of these things, and they're actually quite remarkable phonographs. Now on the right side, the crank side, there's kind of some glare though, so I hope you can kind of see that, but it's rubbed varnish. I did rub this on the back, I'll show you in a second the back, but this whole side here, the veneer is pulling up on this side. Some the escutcheons for these for the crank and for the Vox Humana, they call it, for the volume control. They're rusted, so some WD-40, some Brasso, and clean the metal up. I can get that without any issue. A little bit of dirt caked in the corners there. Couple dents and stuff on the solid wood. Okay, but clearly though, I mean the veneer is the big issue of the day on this. So all that veneer, well, mainly it's pulling off at the back. So I don't know, and the nice gouge in there too. So let me flip this around to the back and show you that. And here's the back. Oops, I just torn off some veneer. And I've rubbed this, wiped this with acetone just to check and see what the varnish was on this. And I have a refinishing book, very rudimentary, that said acetone will clean off some things, and denatured alcohol will clean off other things. The back, there is some pulling of the veneer on the back. Yeah, looks like all front, back, and sides are the worst parts of this as far as the veneer. So one more flip around, and here's the left side. Yeah, I try to pick some stuff off of it and it just makes a bigger dent in it. excuse me, veneer is stuck down on this side. However, you know, it's kind of an uneven shellac or lacquer. Few dents in the wood, which aren't really disastrous except for on this lid. And I know I'm getting a lot of glare in the camera on that. This here is kind of rubbed down and ruined. So yeah, I'm wondering, Scott, if you would be interested in undertaking a refinishing job that might be, if you agree to it and get into it and then say to yourself, what in the heck have I gotten myself into? I mean, it's not a huge, not a huge piece of furniture, but it's hefty and big enough, I guess. I mean, this is a more or less a floor-standing phonograph with the bottom storage area cut off of it. So, one more flip and I'll show you the front. And here's the front of the cabinet. There's some reticulation in the finish here on the lid. I'm not too worried about the grill work, though. There are a few broken places, which I'm willing to say let them be broken because this thing is 100 years old, or will be tomorrow. I've taken a piece of fabric and glued it to the inside. I tried ironing it, and it didn't seem to iron very well. It wrinkled right back up again. The inside of the horn. Now, I've taken the guts out and flipped the bottom out, and I may as well just show you that too while I'm shooting video on this. I'll flip this over and take the bottom cover off and show you that. But it does look like I can, by removal of two screws and the tone arm mounting. Yeah, you can see that. I have the camera set. Take the tone arm off and remove two screws in the front. The horn assembly will come out. So I can give you a gutted cabinet for rebuilding this. So you don't have to worry about any of the guts or anything breaking it or anything like that. So it looks like I am able to give you cabinet only with all the hardware and mechanism removed. Yeah, I kind of don't like how baggy that is. Oh well, not really a major disaster. But anyway, Mr. Scott, that's my questions for you. If you want to think about this, or I can find a antique cabinet restoration outfit who has all the poisonous chemicals and cancer-causing agents, and they're used to using them. Let them screw with it instead of you. So let me know what you think about that. Meanwhile, I have that single Altona in the freezer with a bunch of penetrating oil that I need to check on. So let me look at that real quick. To remove the horn inside, you have to remove the tone arm and the motorboard as well. Two screws here, but I can't get this screw backed out, so that's going to be a problem. So two screws here and two on the front of the cabinet. On the inside, here and here. And this screw is really rusty, and it looks like it's going to be a really difficult thing to take out. Also, you're going to have to remove the volume control too from this, from the little slider up inside. I found a serial number inside. I'm going to write that down. So those two screws and those two screws underneath the tone arm mount, and this horn section should come right out.